We have vast potential. It's unbelievable. It's incredible. If you took all of farm production capacity, we could provide enough calories to feed the whole world all by ourselves.
One of the things I like about Americans is their lack of modesty. But the sheer scale of the Midwestern harvest is difficult for an Englishman to comprehend. Yet, as I discovered last summer, the size of these Oklahoma farms conceals a crucial fact. The wheat growers are in trouble. I'd gone to America to ask two questions. How was the payment in kind program working? And what did American farmers feel about European cereal producers like me? Oklahoma is, of course, where the corn, or maize as we call it, grows as high as an elephant's eye. But in real life, they grow more wheat than maize. And that's why I found myself near the small town of Enid, not far from the Kansas border. Within minutes of arriving at Lauren Werenberg's farm, I was off in his four-wheel drive pickup for a tour of the place. I'd been a bit worried that harvest might already be over. It was late June, and I'd been told that they usually finish in time for the national holiday on the 4th of July. But this year was different, in lots of ways.
This is where one of my boys live, right here.
Lauren and his two sons farm about 3,000 acres. They grow wheat and feed a few cattle and pigs, or hogs as they're called in Oklahoma. The first thing I like to do when visiting a farm is to take a look at the machinery. There's usually something unexpected, especially in America.
What have we got here? We got a Steiger. How many horsepower is that?
That's a 310 horsepower Panther with a Cummins engine and an Allison automatic transmission.
Automatic transmission?
Yes.
Does that work? Are you happy with it?
No, I would never do it. I would never want to give that up.
How many years have you had that set up then?
3 years. This is a third year.
And these are the discs, are they, that you've been disking up all your wheat with?
Yes, this disc here, yes. Yes, that's a Miller 28-foot extra heavy-duty offset disc.
Have you ever had to disc wheat before this year?
Yes, we've disced wheat before, but not to this extent.
Now, these bales we're coming up to, what are they?
That's wheat hay.
That is wheat hay. When was it cut for hay? When the wheat was still green or when it was ripe?
We like to cut it when it's green. This has been a very wet season this year, and so we didn't get it cut like we'd like to get it cut. But it
it looks a nice color.
On the inside of the bale, it'd be nice and green. Yeah.
What's it smell like?
It smells like hay.
Lovely. That wouldn't be.
Now the cows will eat that like candy this winter.
You reckon it's better than a good hay, then, is it?
No, it's not better than alfalfa, but it's makes a lot more tonnage. It's perfect for what we use it for. We use it to supplement wheat pasture.
All this talk of disking and baling wheat showed that this was no ordinary harvest. And on our way out to the combines, I began to realize that the countryside didn't just produce wheat. The fields all around were full of donkeys, the sort which pump oil day and night from deep below the ground. There aren't too many oil wells in my part of East Anglia, so I asked Lauren if I could take a closer look.
I don't think I've ever been this close to an oil well before.
We farm around them all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
How many have you got on the farm?
I'll tell you something here that'll mislead you, but we farm around probably 25 or 30 oil wells, but that doesn't mean we get the production out of all 25 or 30 of them. We get the production out of 6 or 7 or 8 of them.
Whose oil well is this?
The oil well, the equipment that you see belongs to a company by the name of D&H Oil, but the percentage of the oil that comes out of the ground belongs to me.
Can I see any of that oil, or does it go into a tank?
Yeah, sure. It's, Right there is a sample of the oil. I have a little bottle here. I'll show you how much of this is oil. This is not all oil. Part of this is salt water. We'll fill a bottle here. And as you see, the oil will separate quite quickly. The oil line is going to be somewhere right along in here. The rest of this will all be salt water.
That's separating the oil and salt water.
Yeah. This is here's the oil line right here.
Yeah.
The rest of this is all salt water. We're looking at 20% oil and 80% salt water. And so what this does then, this pumps down into the tank battery that I'll show you later. And down there it's separated. The oil goes in one tank, the salt water goes in another tank, and then we have the problem of having to dispose of the salt water, which gets to be quite a problem sometimes.
So that's black gold.
That top inch is black gold, yes.
Yeah. How many dollars a barrel do you get from this well?
I think the last time I figured we was getting about $26 or $27 a barrel. It's kind of hard to say. It depends on how much windfall profits tax comes out of it, and the windfall profits tax is a hard thing to determine.
Okay, call it $26. How much of that stays with you, personally?
$26.
You get $26?
Yes.
And how many barrels a day?
I get $26 for my percentage of the barrels.
Right.
This lease has three wells on it, and the lease makes 40 barrels of oil a day. My part of this lease is almost 10%. My royalty interest, and so I get 4 barrels a day.
But this oil well that we're standing next to now pumping, how many barrels of oil would it produce in a single day?
This happens to be the better well of the wells that's on the lease.
Mm-hmm.
This well makes about 20 barrels of the 40 that's being produced.
20 barrels a day. How many gallons in a barrel?
42.
So that is?
840.
840 gallons of oil a day.
Yeah, crude oil now. That's crude oil. That's not refined oil.
And how deep does this well go down under the ground?
This is what we consider to be a small well. This well's 2,000 feet deep. The ordinary, what we'd call a deep well in this part of the state of Oklahoma would be about 5,000 feet deep. In western Oklahoma, some of the wells get as deep as 20,000.
20,000 feet deep to produce oil?
Well, basically, them are gas wells when you get that deep. But the production of oil here and the production of oil in western Oklahoma is totally two different situations.
You must have pretty divided loyalties, because when we in England find that fuel prices go up, farmers get unhappy, they pay more for their diesel and everything. You must be on the side of OPEC. You must be in favor of high gas prices.
No, not really, because...
high gas prices are good for you personally, are they?
Yes, they are. My oil income exceeds my diesel and my fuel costs by some. Not a great deal, but it does some.
So on your own farm, you're self-sufficient in energy. You actually get more out of the ground than you use in your machinery.
That's true. Yes, yes, yes. That's somewhat of an unusual situation, but that's the case. That's not don't go back to England and say that all farmers in the state of Oklahoma are self-sufficient in fuel, because that's not the case. Many, many, many people were hurt badly by the oil business. A lot of the farmers got into the production business. They got into different kinds of service businesses that they really didn't have any expertise in. The money was good temporarily. They invested heavily. And there's been lots of farmers in the state of Oklahoma who have virtually lost everything because they invested in the oil business, and the oil business has gone down.
But wheat, quite as much as oil, is Oklahoma's major business. Here they grow a hard red winter wheat that would make my local flour miller jump for joy. At 14%, its protein may be wonderful, but its yields, by English standards, are not so exciting. Lauren estimated this field would make an above average 40 bushels an acre, just over a ton. However, they also get 4 months grazing for the cattle in the winter months.
About 6 weeks after we plant it, about the 15th of November, we turn the cows on it, and we pasture our cattle on the wheat all winter until the 1st of March.
And That doesn't seem to affect its growth in the spring?
As a matter of fact, it's debatable. Some people contend that proper pasturing will increase the quality or increase the yields of the grain because it has a tendency to pack the ground and you don't have any winter kill. It doesn't bother the wheat at all from a production standpoint to pasture the wheat, no.
What about diseases of wheat? Rusts and mildews, take-all, any of those?
We have very little problem that way.
You've obviously got a very good rotation then. I mean, what's the rotation on this field?
100 years of continuous wheat.
Come off it.
Almost 100 years, since 1893, I suppose.
Continuous wheat here?
Continuous wheat. We will occasionally, of course, pasture out, maybe bale some of it for hay. But there's many, many fields in this country that have probably had wheat panama on them every year.
Well, why that? It makes more money? Why don't you use a rotation?
What would we rotate with? Well, there's nothing else that will produce in this part of the state of Oklahoma. You can't grow cotton, you can't grow peanuts, you can't grow grain sorghum, you can't grow corn. You can grow oats and barley. It's not a sure thing. Wheat is the surest thing. We planted all the wheat.
Meanwhile, under threatening skies, the eldest son, Donnie, was trying to get a bit more combine before the heavens opened. Ironically, they were having just the sort of catchy harvest that we're used to in England.
So with a thunderstorm rumbling on behind me, it looks as if the Oklahoma harvest once again is going to grind to a halt. It's all a bit reminiscent of home. But this field isn't reminiscent of home. It was drilled on September the 25th with about 75 pounds of seed to the acre, 100 units of nitrogen, 50 units of phosphate. And since the drill left the field until the combine arrived in the field this morning, nothing's been done whatsoever. No herbicides, no fungicides, no insecticides, nothing. And in spite of it, it doesn't look too bad a crop. They reckon it'll be about a ton an acre, which, all things considered, is pretty good.
Yield in this part of the world is determined almost completely by rainfall, and this year there'd been plenty. But I couldn't help wondering, though, what might have happened if Lauren and his fellow farmers had used a bit more fertilizer and a fungicide or two. But Oklahoma, and the rest of America too, is low input country. And if your inputs are low, you can't afford to spend a lot on combines. These Alice Charmer gleaners are not sold in Europe. And looking at their lack of guards, I began to see why. I wondered what my local safety officer back home would say if he were ever faced with a machine like this. Oklahoma stubbles are a lot higher than they are in Cambridgeshire, and there's a lot less straw to incorporate. Burning, of course, is unheard of in this normally tinder-dry climate. So the deliberate starting of fires is considered criminal, literally. Once the combines have left the field, those heavy discs move in. Moldboard plows are almost never seen. Using discs to make a seedbed is something I'm very familiar with because we do it every autumn at home. But on Lauren's farm, I saw a sight I hope I'll never see again. He was using them to destroy a standing crop. And yet, across America last summer, this was a common sight, as fields of wheat were disked up, often just a few days before the combine should have entered the field. It looked like an act of madness, but there was a reason. To qualify for the government's payment in kind, the crop had first to be destroyed. Enid, Oklahoma produces both fuel and food, but in these days of an oil glut and a grain surplus, it might be easier if it did neither. It calls itself the wheat capital of the world and has the biggest grain elevators in America. They would hold 10% of the entire British wheat crop. What's more, every grain in these silos goes for export. Each June, this quiet little town is transformed. as the juggernauts move in from Texas in the south and Kansas in the north. Mile after mile, they line up as traffic in Enid comes to a standstill. In a normal year, the wheat only stays in Enid for a short time before freight trains haul it down to the Gulf of Mexico, where it's exported to the world. But last year was anything but normal. A few days after the start of harvest, everything stopped. Enid was once again empty and deserted. The reason was not hard to find. The silos were so full with the old crop that they just didn't have space for the new. And all because they couldn't export their wheat. The government's response to this crisis had been twofold: aggressive selling abroad and the payment in kind or PIC program at home. PIC was simple in theory, but complicated and very expensive in practice. For every acre of wheat that a farmer did not harvest, he would receive 95% of his expected yield in the form of grain from government stocks. The snag was that by the time PIC was announced, the winter wheat all over America had already been drilled. To qualify for the scheme, the farmers had to destroy the crop before harvest. Some farmers even went as far as putting their entire crop into the PIC program, effectively shutting down the farm for a whole year. Lauren hadn't gone quite this far. He'd either made hay or disced half of his wheat crop. A pretty desperate solution for what he and most other farmers thought was a pretty desperate problem.
Even though we don't make the kind of bushels of wheat per acre that you all do in England, we still consider ourselves to be more efficient in the production of a bushel of wheat because we probably don't have the costs that you all do. We farm larger acreages. Our cost is not as great. We probably produce a bushel of wheat more efficiently. Now, the reason that this PIC was necessary was that we're building up a tremendous surplus in this country. And the cost of just storing this surplus was getting plumb out of line as far as the government was concerned. And so there had to be something done, or if we'd gone another year, we'd have been had an atrocious problem. There's many, many wheat farmers that have to be in bad financial trouble. There's no question about it. Being an American wheat farmer is a tough business. The PIC program it has to be hard on the natural resources of a country. We've got fertilizer that takes fuel to produce that's gone. We've used machinery to produce a crop that we're disking under. We've used manpower that we're not going to have anything but a disk under crop to account for it. Yes, it has to be somewhat tough on the country in general. We are. The country itself is making a sacrifice, yes. If we don't do something to cut down on our surpluses and to build a market for the American farmer, someday we just won't be able to produce. Either that or the government will have to so heavily subsidize it that the taxpayer just wouldn't be able to stand it. We had the market one time, but our market slipped away from us. And it's a little hard for me as an American farmer to compete with an American farmer or with a farmer in Europe when the European governments are subsidizing their farmers to the extent that they are. If the United States government was subsidizing me to where I was getting $5.50 or $6 a bushel for my wheat, I'd plow up all the pastures and we could really produce wheat in this country. We're not looking for a trade war. We don't want to do those kinds of things. But we would like to be able to compete on a fair basis with the rest of the world.
It was becoming clear that we European cereal producers were hardly the most popular people in the American wheat belt last summer. It's true, of course, that American farmers also get help from their government in various forms of loans and subsidies. But in spite of all this, I had to feel some sympathy with Lauren. Any European farmer with 3,000 acres would be a far richer man with a more comfortable life and an easier climate. But here, Lauren's entire family had been pressed into service to help with the harvest. Some of the crop is stored on the farm for selling later in the year, but most goes straight off the combine to the local cooperative's grain store. The price, chalked up outside, $3.25 a bushel, works out at about £82 per ton. The same 14% protein wheat last harvest in England would have fetched at least £140 a ton. No wonder Lauren felt a bit hard done by. But the fact is that 80% of Oklahoma's wheat goes for export and is therefore at the mercy of the unpredictable world markets. It makes the Oklahoma farmer very vulnerable.
It appears to me that one of the principal difficulties is that the American farmer is stuck with handling much of the variability in production and consumption around the world. When we have a shortage of wheat or other crops around the world, the EEC farmer gets no signals. That is, he is insulated from knowing that there's a shortage of wheat in the world by the high prices. So he does not get the signal that would encourage the producer to increase output. The consumer does not get the signal to cut consumption. And so the burden of handling unstable supplies falls very heavily on the American farmer and the U.S. economy in total.
Talking to some people in Washington, they suggested to us that the money that was spent on pick shouldn't go to the farmers, it should go to the other end of the chain, should in other words be used to subsidize exports and get rid of the stuff.
Well, there are limits to the extent which we can use export subsidies. As you know, we're already employing some methods of assisting our exports. We would get into an incredible price war, and it would not be just the European community that would be the loser, it would be Americans as well. And we want to avoid that kind of price war, and we'd appreciate a little assistance from the European community.
You say we would get into an incredible price war. Some people would suggest we're already in one.
Well, no, we shot a blast across the bow, so to speak, in the case of flour subsidies to Egypt. But we have tremendous reserves to draw on in terms of supplementing our export subsidies. We have the potential for using a payment in kind to subsidize exports. We have much reserves to draw on in terms of our treasury. Our export subsidies are very, very modest compared to what the EEC is doing.
The EEC wants to play that kind of game. You know, we've got the tools to play that kind of game. We hope we don't have to do that.
As a high-cost cereal producer, I hope so too. But the solution is far from simple. Pick was only partly successful. It certainly managed to reduce the American wheat crop. But since yields last harvest were good, and farmers only put their poorest land into the scheme, the effect was not as great as the government had hoped. It also cost a staggering $20 billion, so this year's pick will be a lot less generous. Meanwhile, the Enid silos are still bulging, and the farmers of Oklahoma have thrown caution to the winds as they planted wheat from fence row to fence row. So the news for British farmers and Brussels bureaucrats alike is gloomy. Once again, the world wheat surplus looks certain to increase.
Thoroughly simplistic super seeds is superior sprayer. System structurally sound herbicides, pesticides, seasonal specialized sensational sprayers, thousands of hectares, cereal spraying, threaten pests, destroy weeds. Subtitles.
Orman, altogether a better sprayer. Well, we got a good start from Pyramin pre-emergence. There's not a weed between us, and Pyramin didn't hurt us at all. That lot missed their Pyramin pre-emergence. Just look at the weeds.
And the new low dose rates mean even lower cost.
Pyramin, from your BASF distributor.
Here is the latest news read by Nematode.
And so pressed.
It was revealed today that my late flesh, Temmick...
He's putting down Temmick.
Oh, no.
Not Temmick from Union Carbide.
This means famine. No more juicy seedlings, potatoes, sugar beet, carrots, peas, brassica.
Here, aphids, the other pests, gone.
Our failure correspondent informs me of a mass airborne evacuation.
And now the weather.
Move like lightning.
When your wild oat problem looks like this, you need Avenge. Avenge really kills wild oats, regularly achieving 100% control for maximum yield benefit from early wild oat removal, plus the bonus of mildew control too. Avenge can be tank mixed with over 40 spray chemicals and applied from early tillering right up to third node in both wheat and barley. Use Avenge, Britain's number one, for a clean, high-yielding crop to be proud of.
Nissan Datsun cars and commercials, 2% per annum finance and 3-year warranty. Ring Serval Motor Group, Hitchin 35449.
Everything today is thoroughly modern. Bird's Eye Oven Krispies, caught in batter in the oven you pop. Traditional deliciousness, goodbye. Old frying pan, I'm changing and how. So hear that. Bird's Eye Oven Crispy Cod. It's thoroughly modern, but it tastes traditional.
I think Brookfield really grabbed us in different ways. The challenge of living in London. Everybody says it's a hard city.
Hello, Roy.
Hello, Nick.
How are you?
Good
to meet you. Pleasant journey?
Not too bad.
Good. Come on in. Come on in. So what colour are we going to have this week?
Not orange.
It's orange, yeah?
Jackie and I have been at Brookfield for 2 weeks now. We have been employed by the Church Army to run Brookfield House as warden and housekeeper.
Sorry.
Brookfield House is a holiday and conference centre in Victoria, in the city of Westminster.
Sarah?
Yes, that's
Sarah
right.
Simpson.
Hello.
You must be Neil.
Hello.
All sorts of groups come to Brookfield for various reasons. We get people such as school parties, church groups, youth groups from youth clubs, which have no sort of connection to church. We're not just open for Christian groups, we're open to non-Christian groups too.
I think I'll ask you just to duck.
The important thing was to get straight in with the groups that are arriving, because we didn't have a slack period. We were straight in at the deep end. So we had to wash up, we had to cook, we had to serve at tables.
Yeah, easy to do that. Yeah.
It's very easy at Brookfield House to work and work and work. There's lots to do, and at the moment, in a way, it does seem a little overpowering.
Neil had catering training and experience, and that obviously is valuable working in a situation such as this. But I think primarily we were looking for somebody who would take time to be with people.
When Jackie and I had the interview for the warden and housekeeper at Brookfield House, the interview was very informal.
We arrived and had lunch with the three interviewers and the other two interviewees. which seemed to me very strange anyway. it was a lovely lunch. We really got chatting, really relaxed. We thought interview would be just great, sail through.
As interviews go generally, I feel I'm very capable and can come over very well. But for some reason, this interview, I just sort of went to pot, basically.
I've never seen you so tense. He's usually, and he is, so dominant and outgoing. And I kept thinking, what's the matter with him, you know? He just didn't know how to answer the questions. I thought he'd gone silly.
I think we were looking for a couple who would work together and, as far as possible, make this a home for the people who come. And we felt that Neil and Jackie would be the right couple to do that.
The first feeling the following day, really, was that we didn't get a job on our own strength. But it was God's guiding hand in all of it.
When the job was offered to us, I just cried because I didn't want to come up to London. I didn't want to leave my family. I didn't want to leave my job. I didn't want to move up to this big city and work in a place that I didn't like.
Before Brookfield, we were living in Weymouth. Because you're so young, you just grow up together and your whole way of life blends in. Jackie was working as clerical assistant officer at County Hall in Dorchester. We actually moved into a two-bedroom flat. The view was superb. You actually could see just about my hotel, Portland. The job, it took all different forms, organising staff in the restaurant, and very much so liaising with the chef and running the hotel when the manager was absent. So we felt very much at home. I thought when I became a Christian that the first thing I should do was go into a mission or something, but that wasn't right. As a Christian, wherever you are, you're working for God. But this evolved and came about. God was leading us towards the house. So we...